Christ Church.
Oh,
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated, and I invite the children forward.
Are talking about when Jesus calms the storm, which I think is pretty fitting for the last week we've had. A lot of rain. I'm sure we've heard the story before. So, Jesus and his disciples are traveling around telling the word of God, right? And there's a storm while they're on a boat. And Jesus wakes up and he says, "Quiet, be calm." And the storm calms down. Because the disciples were very scared. So Jesus turned to them and said, "Why are you afraid? Did you not have faith?" And that just reminds us that we should always have faith. So when we have storms, like we have this last week, if we have faith in God, we know that everything will be okay. So, with that moral of the story, very quick, how about we pray so we can go to Sunday school, okay? God, thank you for reminding us to have faith in you and for putting our trust in you. Amen. For the fifth Sunday of Pentecost, let us pray. O God, our defender, storms rage about us and cause us to be afraid. Rescue your people from despair. Deliver your sons and daughters from fear and preserve us from all unbelief. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Today's Old Testament reading is the familiar story of David and Goliath. The passages leading up to today's reading detail the size of Goliath and his impressive armor and weapons. They use units of measure that we don't really know what they mean, but suffice it to say, Goliath is portrayed as a truly awesome and terrifying presence on the battlefield. A reading beginning the 17th verse. David rose early in the morning, left the sheep with the keeper, took the provisions, and went as Jesse had commanded him. He came to the encampment as the army was going forth to the battle line, shouting the war cry. Israel and the Philistines drew up for battle, army against army. David left the things in charge of the keeper of the baggage and ran to the ranks, and went and greeted his brothers. As he talked with them, the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, came out of the ranks of the Philistines and spoke the same challenging words as before, and David heard them. David said to Saul, "Let no one's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Saul said to David, You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are just a boy, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep sheep for his father, and whenever a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock, I went after it and struck it down and killed it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them. And since he has defied the armies of the living God, the Lord who saved me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will save me from the hand of this Philistine." So Saul said to David, "Go, and may the Lord be with you." Saul clothed David with his armor, put a bronze helmet in his head, and clothed him with a coat of mail. And David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and he tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. And then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk in these, for I am not used to them." So David removed them. And then he took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the wadi and put them in his shepherd's bag in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The Philistine came on and drew near to David with his shield bearer in front of him. When the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David in the name of the Philistine gods. And the Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the field." But David said to Goliath, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head, and I will give the dead bodies of the Philistine armies this very day to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the earth, so that all the earth may know there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand." When the Philistine drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet Goliath. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The New Testament reading is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, beginning in chapter 6, verses 1 to 13. As we work together with him, we urge you not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way so that no fault may be found in our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way through the great endurance in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, and hunger. Through purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, and truthful speech, and the power of God. With the weapons of righteousness in our right hand and in our left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute, we are treated as impostors, yet we are true, as unknown, and yet are well known, as dying and seeing, we are alive, as punished, but not yet killed, as sorrowful, but always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, yet possessing everything. We have spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open to you. There is no restriction in our affections, but only in yours. In return, I speak to you as children. Open wide your hearts. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
On that day, when evening had come, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose and the waves beat into the boat so that the boat was already swamped. But he was in the stern asleep on the cushion, and they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Let us pray. We wait for you, Lord. Our souls wait for you, and your word is our hope. Amen. Well, good morning, everyone. Good to be with you. Good to see you. I don't have as much of a peanut gallery audience back here, but I think at least one of them is going to have some opinions about what I have to say. Yeah, there'll be a quiz for you, Ron. I wasn't here last week. Last week, right around now, I was sitting on an island in Georgian Bay. There's a group of old friends, some of them I've known almost 50 years, and we go every year, we go and kayak and camp on this island. So it's a good experience, but I gotta tell you, I look a little more presentable today than I did a week ago today, on the third day on the island. So anyway, enough said about that. And I'm really grateful that Luigi was able to pitch in and take the service for me last week. So I want to say thank you for that. Well, today we have a very familiar gospel story, right? This is lovely and simple. It soothes and calms us much as Jesus hushed the water. Most of us have heard this story many times, and I bet a lot of you could have this story pretty much by heart. So, you know, if I called on Harry, I'm pretty sure he could stand up and tell me the whole thing, right, Harry? But the problem is Harry also would have to weave in a really long joke. He just can't restrain himself. Can't help it. So after a long day of teaching, Jesus instructs the disciples to get into their fishing boat to sail across the Sea of Galilee, right? And a storm comes as Jesus sleeps. And he's not just sleeping. Did you notice in the gospel? He's not just sleeping. He's sleeping what? Anybody notice? What? I think you got it, Peter. He's sleeping on a cushion. I mean, this guy is really taking it easy there. And the disciples panic, understandably. They wake Jesus up. They accuse him of not caring. Jesus says, "Peace, be still." The water grows tranquil. Jesus asks about their lack of faith. They are in awe that even the wind and the sea obey him. In some ways, nothing need be added to this story. And this story is definitely one of Jesus' greatest hits. Don't you agree? Yeah, it's so familiar. Even so, since I'm a professional talker, I can think of one or two things to say here. And there are two themes in particular that I invite you to notice about this story that perhaps you've not noticed before, worth exploring. I want to look at the phrase, the other side, believe it or not, the other side of the sea. And I will look at the phrase, peace be still. So first of all, Jesus says to take the boat to the other side. You notice that detail? Take the boat to the other side. And on first reading, we look at that and we just think, well, it's just geography. They're on one side, they're going to the other side, right? Seems like it's just a simple detail of geography. We call the water the Sea of Galilee, by the way. Who has any of you ever been there? A few of you have been there. It's called the Sea of Galilee, which sounds really big, doesn't it? But it sounds big, but it's not big. It's actually a small lake, small by Great Lake standards, for sure. It's 21 kilometers by 13 kilometers. It's one quarter the size of the city of Toronto, and Lake Ontario is 100 times larger than the Sea of Galilee. But you know, even though it's a small sea, it can still be dangerous. Small bodies of water can be dangerous, as I learned once a few years ago, and maybe I'll tell you more about this sometime, when I was canoeing, actually, on a river just 40 feet across, and I almost drowned. So a small body of water can be dangerous. But there's more going on here than just geography. When Jesus takes people to the other side, what Jesus is doing is Jesus is taking them to another culture. He's taking them to another country. He's taking them into unfamiliar circumstances. So it's just not just a matter of going in the boat from one shore to the next shore. This is what we might call boundary crossing. And in the next story, Jesus and the disciples find themselves in a strange land, the land of the Gerasenes, where people are possessed of unclean spirits living in a tomb. Now, crossing the sea or crossing a body of water, we know this has many connotations, right? Where else do we see this in the Bible? Crossing a body of water. Parting the Red Sea, exactly. Where else do we see it? It's sort of like a kind of small echo of the parting of the Red Sea. Do you remember? Crossing the Jordan River, right. And we ourselves have connotations and associations with crossing water, right? My parents crossed the water to immigrate here to Canada. That's true of some of your parents. In fact, it's true of a number of people in this congregation that you yourselves crossed maybe more than one body of water to get here to Canada. I have Indigenous friends who remind me that almost everybody I hang around with are immigrants or descendants of immigrants. But the immigration experience to immigrate to Canada, unless you're coming from the other side of the border, we all crossed water, right? So this crossing of water has all kinds of associations and things to think about that I also think are embedded in this story. Now, my family, as I mentioned tiresomely often, have come from another country. And when we or people close to us encounter different cultures, two things often happen. We encounter new people, new cultures, we encounter new ways of doing things. That's one thing that happens. And also, newcomers are often regarded as different or even as threats, different or other. Does that make sense? I'll say a little bit more about it. I know that my family was not the only one, and I'll bet this is true for some of you too. I'm sure my family was not the only, we're not the only people to hear the phrase, "Why don't you go back to where you came from?" We heard that a number of times back in the 1950s, and Dutch people were called DPs, and they found that DP stood for displaced persons, and to the end of his life, my dad was aggrieved about that. Now, we were white people, so I want to acknowledge that the suffering and rejection that we experienced is nothing compared to other cultures or traditions. Now, when we meet someone who's different, we have a choice. We can reach out to them with compassion, we can try to get to know them, or sometimes we choose to feel safe by rejecting people who are different than us. And in our case, growing up, we were suspicious of anybody who was not Dutch. Our family, if you weren't Dutch, our family dismissed you as Canadian. So, Ken, did some of your ancestors came from Kenya, right? Nigeria. So, Ken, I got bad news for you. You're Canadian. They run into you, you'd be Canadian. And we kind of wrote off all groups as Canadian. Now, I know Ron grew up in a much more liberal, tolerated Dutch culture than I did. No matter what the ethnicity it was, no matter whether they were born here, no matter whether English was or French was their first language, no matter whether they came from any part of the world except Holland, they were Canadians. And we were a little suspicious of Canadians. And, sorry, we got some talk back going on? Catherine, did you have, what? No? I'm coming apart at the seams here. All right, I don't mind talk back, you know. I don't mind being heckled, just for the record. All right, so we were suspicious of, and that's kind of funny, because I mean, they chose Canada, right? So it's kind of odd. But anyway, we just hung around with Dutch people all the time. We hung around with Dutch people. We protected ourselves by hanging around with Dutch people. My dad's friends were Dutch. His employees were Dutch. His customers were Dutch. I went to a school that was called a Christian school. We were all Dutch, and we were all from the same denomination. Everybody in our church was Dutch. We went to the Shell station. Shell is a Dutch corporation. And it was owned by a Dutch member of our congregation. And so, you know, we'd pull up to the pumps, and we'd see other Dutch people from our church, and we kind of nod and smile because, you know, we were like a secret society, a secret club. And we had a Dutch butcher, and we had a Dutch baker. And if we needed a candlestick maker, I'm sure we would have found a Dutch one. They came right to our door. Our electrician was Dutch. His brother was our plumber. He was Dutch. They were both members of our church. A block away from the Dutch Shell station was a Dutch credit union where I got my first bank account. Yeah, still exists. Duca, it's called now. And next to that was a Dutch store that carried Dutch delicacies and pastries and dry goods, and we patronized them because here's something I'm pretty sure not many of you know. I know Ron knows it. Many of you do not realize that Canadian underwear is just not as good as Dutch underwear. Right, Ron? So we went to the Dutch dry goods store. Now, we protected ourselves, really. Do you see that? We were protecting ourselves by hanging around with people who were familiar, who were like us, right? That's a kind of natural human tendency. And well, why do we do that? We do that because we're afraid. We do that out of fear. And it's hard. It's hard to face so much difference. And we also protected ourselves by being prejudiced against Canadians. And basically, you're all Canadians, all right? Not just Ken, everybody here, you're all Canadians, whatever your background. And I was told a lot of things about Canadians growing up. I learned that Canadians do not save money. That's what I heard. I learned that Canadians don't like to work hard. I learned that. And that Canadians form labor unions. Labor unions was a cuss phrase in my household growing up. Canadians are pretty much not trustworthy. That was the message I heard. And I remember the first Canadian my dad hired, his name was Mr. Goldfinch. And was it Goldfinch? Goldfinch, yeah, it was Mr. Goldfinch. And he had a Goldfinch tattooed on his arm. And I'd never seen a tattoo before. And I commented on that to my mom, and she said, well, he used to be in prison. So that was the first Canadian we hired. And then we hired a bookkeeper, a Canadian book. When our Dutch bookkeeper retired, we couldn't find another Dutch bookkeeper, so we hired a Canadian woman who proceeded to steal all the financial records and hold them ransom before she gave them back. So I was raised not really being impressed by Canadians. Okay, my notes have been jumbled in transit. Now, I tell you all this for several reasons, but really the main reason is that when Jesus told the disciples to go to the other side of the water, he was telling them to be prepared to meet people who were different, who were going to unsettle them, who were going to challenge them and give them a different perspective. And this is a big theme in the Gospels. Jesus keeps breaking down barriers between peoples and groups. Jesus broke down barriers between Jews and Gentiles, between clean and unclean, between the well and the unwell. In the famous Good Samaritan story, where even the clergy try to avoid somebody different, Jesus teaches us, reminds us, not only do we not need to fear the other, we do not need to feel people who are different. In fact, we ought to reach out to people who are different than us. We reach out with compassion and with curiosity and with love. And this is a message that is as relevant to us now as it has ever been. A lot of American politics, as you know, which we hear about here, especially evident for the last almost a decade now, or more, longer than that, actually. A lot of American politics is driven by fear of the other. And politicians are exploiting people's fear of the other. That's one of the reasons why the Black Lives Matter movement had to grow up, had to come up, rather. And they were responding that black folks should not be treated as disposable, should not be treated as dispensable, should not be treated as other. And these concerns, while are more obvious on the other side of the border, are also true here on this side of the border in Canada. We have, as you know, a high rate of immigration. Toronto has a high proportion of immigrants. The neighborhood I previously lived in Toronto, where St. Paul's Lamoureux is, 95% of people in that area were not born in Canada. And the 5% who were born in Canada, many of them, their parents were not born in Canada. So these are issues that are important for us to think about, especially as we see politicians trying to exploit and aggravate fears. And of course, we've had our own incidences of terrible kinds of violence to people who are other, like that misguided young Canadian terrorist who used his truck to kill off a Muslim family in London. We Canadians are challenged to embrace across lines, to reach out. When we deal with people who are different, Jesus teaches us not to be afraid. Jesus teaches us to be at peace. We need not fear other people, no matter their skin color, or their culture, or their language, or their beliefs. We as Christians, as followers of Jesus, as disciples of Christ, respect others, and we do not act in fear of others, and we don't act in fear even when we are labeled as others, even when we are dismissed. You know, I'm fond of my Dutch heritage, I think you can tell, but some of my upbringing now looks at least a little weird to me, Ron, just a little. But I don't judge my parents or church for that. I make jokes about it, but I don't judge them because I see how insecure they were and that they were acting out of fear. But what I have learned since then is that acting out of fear almost always does more damage than it does good. And Jesus is inviting us to a different place. Now, Jesus was sleeping in the boat on a cushion when the storm came, and that storm almost swamped the boat, and not surprisingly, the disciples were afraid. They were terrified, and in great desperation, they woke Jesus up. "Why aren't you afraid?" they asked. And an Orthodox priest has argued that the disciples' desperate question meant, "Why don't you care? Why don't you care for us? Why aren't you worried when we're being threatened with dying, with perishing?" And what this priest noticed is that what the disciples wanted in that moment was they wanted Jesus to share their anxiety. They wanted Jesus to share their fear. They wanted him to be as afraid as they are. They think that Jesus won't help unless he's scared. Now, Jesus, of course, intriguingly does help, but he's not afraid. He doesn't share their anxiety. He doesn't share their panic. He remains centered. He remains serene. And he solves the problem by throwing his own serenity onto the storm. Peace be still. But he's also throwing it onto his disciples. When we are scared or anxious, it's easy to want others to be scared and anxious, as if saying to God, "You don't feel what I feel, and therefore you don't care." This is my complaint about many Christians south of the border. They want to recruit God for their agenda. They want God to be angry and hateful and afraid. But, sisters and brothers, God does not play along with such agenda. "Peace be still," says Jesus, to the wind and the waves. And he also says that to us. We can trust God. We can trust God when we encounter people we don't understand. And we can trust and rely on God when others don't understand us. This is a major theme of the New Testament, God bringing people together, God reconciling different races, Jews and Gentiles. When people's lives are genuinely touched by God, they work for a better world. I think of St. Francis, who sought reconciliation with Muslims. I think of the Christians in Europe and North America who opposed slavery and worked for abolition. I think of Mother Teresa, who tended untouchables in Calcutta. And I think of those Christians, not enough, but nevertheless they were there, who protected Jews and other persecuted people in Nazi Germany. I think of the many Christians across many lines who worked for civil rights in North America. I worry about a lot of things when I read or hear the news, but the older I get, the more convinced I am that the way forward is always being by relying on God, the God who reconciles us through Jesus Christ, who reconciles us at all levels and in all ways. Sisters and brothers, peace be still. Keep trusting, keep trusting, keep trusting to the glory of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In response to the proclaimed gospel, I invite you to recite together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again, ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray.
We find ourselves in a violent, storm-tossed world. Let us gather our needs and concerns to call upon our God, saying, O Lord, hear our prayer. As the raging storm compelled the apostles to wake your Son, help us, O God, to weather the squalls that wake us to your presence. We pray, O Lord, hear our prayer. As your Son bound the fury of the sea with his word, teach us to bind our science and technology with human dignity. We pray, O Lord, hear our prayer. As Christ Jesus calmed the storm for the disciples' journey, calm whatever storms our travelers encounter and bring them safely home. We pray, O Lord, hear our prayer. As Jesus once stilled the waves which buffeted the boat, quiet the rifts in our lives, and in the lives for all whom we pray, especially Michael and Simon. We pray, O Lord, hear our prayer. As young parents marvel at the birth of their child, grant us ever to marvel at our new life in Christ. We pray, O Lord, hear our prayer. As children delight in the world through the encouragement of their parents, help us to encourage one another to give thanks and praise to you for the wonders of creation. We pray, O Lord, hear our prayer. Caring God, we thank you for being with us through both the fury and the calm of our life's voyage, revealing your care to us and drawing us to new life. May we live, as we pray, in the protection of Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. God welcomes sinners and invites them to this table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Thank you.
nothing can compare.
Let us pray. Almighty God, guide and protect your eternal God. You have made our Savior Jesus Christ the head of all creation. We receive all we offer you this day and renew us in his risen life. In the name of Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. By water and the Holy Spirit, you have made us a holy people. In Jesus Christ our Lord, you renew that mystery in bread and wine and nourish us to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the holy people who have served you in every age, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name, who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna.
We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil, and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, the death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." And therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant, and unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we made acceptable in him may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing. Creator of all, you gave us golden fields of wheat, whose many grains we have gathered and made into this one bread. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray. Almighty God, guide and protect your people who share in this sacred mystery, and keep us always in your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of Jesus Christ. And may the blessing of God, the Father Almighty, God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. Amen. You may be seated. Three birthdays in the congregation. What's that? I can't hear.
Jay.
Jay?
No, Jay. There may be four.
There may be. I think I said at least three. So, Lisa? Lisa has a birthday. There's Lisa. I saw you today and I thought, I don't know her name yet. So, okay, Lisa has a birthday. Very good. And Samir has a birthday. Where'd Samir end up? Here's Samir. And John has a birthday. John Yelkama.
Hey, John.
Come on, man. Come on. Be a little more enthusiastic. You have a birthday, Ken? It's Ken's birthday tomorrow. Very good. Martha? Had it last week. Still want to get in there anyway. Eh? All right. What's that? Okay. You've been prompted? Good, good, good. Other birthdays we need to know about? All right. Da-da-da-da-da-da. I think there are announcements. Tim is acting like he has an announcement. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. You're welcome, Tim.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
A blessed day I'm having this morning. As you might have seen in your bulletin, we are planning on a refacing of our glorious kitchen downstairs. Our ministry of the kitchen downstairs. It's our Sunday ministry that we tend to do, and we get a lot of people involved in preparing foods for everybody. But the kitchen has been lacking since I've been a member of this church. There's never been an update or an upgrade or a paint or a ceiling tile or anything like that. So we're planning on a treasure sale, if you see in your bulletin, on the 20th of July. We're looking for some items on the bulletin. You'll see the items that we're looking for. We do not want any books. It's not the bazaar. We do not want any CDs, because nobody uses them. We do not want any VHS tapes. If you have a beta machine, I'm looking for one.
It's not a garage sale.
It is a treasure sale. So if you look in your bulletins, we have a couple of days to bring donations in. We can't bring them in and just leave them at Martha's desk. So in the bulletin it says Friday, July the 12th from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. Everything's going to be done through the kitchen entrance at the side of the building. And on the 13th from 12 p.m. to 6 p.m. is when we're going to receive items we can actually make money on for this project. This project it's an undertaking. I've got a few quotes from a few people, and we are all the way up to $28,000 to redo our kitchen, and we said, we don't need that kind of expense on our kitchen, right? We just need to update it and make it nice. So we've got some quotes, and the quotes have been accepted by the production team that I've acquired, and we're going forward with this. Whether this sale works 100% or not, we're going to go forward. There's a lot of donations from the people of this parish, There's many donations from, and time donated from the Sunday night NA group that uses our facilities on Sunday nights, and we're gracious to have them help us as they do use our facility, and they want to help make it good for all of us. So if you do have some stuff you're trying to get rid of, please let us know. My number should be here. I think it is here. Is it here, Martha? It's in the bulletin. So if you need to call and talk about whether it's an item that we could use, give me a call. No problem. I'll answer the phone from anybody, unless it says you live in Arizona. I don't know anybody from Arizona. With that, I think that's all I wanted to talk about. Anybody, Catherine, do you have anything else to say? No? Okay, so with that, you're a little up to date. This is my first announcement in a while, and it's not about golf. So, John thought I was going golfing today, but I'm not. I just wear golf clothes all the time. With that, leave it up to your discretion on what you can donate, and maybe even lend a helping hand. With that, I'll let you have a great Sunday. Thank you.
Are there other announcements? Okay, this is about golf. Okay.
Monday could be the first time in many years that a Canadian team wins the Stanley Cup. So, okay. Looking forward to Edmonton going forward. Thanks.
All right. One thing about my job is sooner or later, I always get the last word, Tim. I will bide my time. All right. I invite you to stand for the closing hymn. Now thank we all our God.
Our Eucharist has ended. Our service now begins. Go forth in the name of Christ.
All right, first one out again. Yes. Yeah.